Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for your patience. I have an announcement to make before we begin this celebration of George's life, and it's for the folks who are here in person today. I want to let you know that the family learned this morning that one of the family members has tested positive for COVID. This is our new normal, right? And so we've done some investigation. That's why we're running a little bit late this morning. And I'm feeling pretty confident that the chances of exposure from anyone in the family who's here are pretty small. And it's not zero, which is why I'm letting you know. The person who tested positive is not here today. The family members who are with that person in their hotel room are not here today. The other family members are. We all shared space outside for George's graveside service yesterday, and the family shared dinner last night. So, again, chances of exposure are small. They're not zero, and I feel like I wanted to let you know that. What we're planning to do today is we have the family sitting over here with plenty of distance around them from everyone else. We've opened windows. There's good ventilation here. All of the family will stay masked even when they're speaking, and I will do the same today. So we feel like we've taken the best precautions that we can. I wanted to let you know before I bring the family in so that if anyone feels like for their own health and safety they need to not be here, this would be a time for that to happen. I'm sorry to put you on the spot, and I thought it was more important to be transparent. So this would be a time to step out if you feel like you need to. We'll take just a minute and then we'll bring the family in and we'll get started. So thank you so much for your understanding, for your compassion and care for each other and for the community.
Thank you.
Good morning again. We welcome you to this celebration of life for George Robert Lanning. Thank you so much for gathering together in all the ways that we gather so that we can remember and honor George. I'm the Reverend Mary Geer, minister for the Olympia Unitarian Universalist Congregation, George's Church. I'm joined today by Troy Fisher, OUUC's music director, and the OUUC choir. This service is different and yet the same. The same because it is a tradition as old as humanity to gather to grieve when a person dies. We gather particularly when the person was so loved, so generous, and so filled with life. And it is different because we are streaming the service today, and some of us are in different physical locations, and we'll speak from those locations. We've gathered virtually for the health and safety of all of us, and we're grateful that you are here in whatever way you have arrived. It is the practice of this congregation to light a chalice, the symbol of our Unitarian Universalist tradition. May the cup be a symbol of our community of love, and the flame a symbol of the life that is in each of us and lives on. For those online, if you have a chalice or a candle, please join me as we light them together. These words are from Mira Mikowitz. We light this chalice, which transforms wax into pure light and warmth, to remind us of our own living, transforming the stuff of this world into the love and activity of our daily lives. As we remember George, may today bring forth transformation in ourselves, from grief, healing, from memory, wholeness, and from celebration, love. Thank you all for offering the gift of your presence today. It matters that you are here. May this be a time and a place for each one of us to experience the spirit of love and healing. We gather today to grieve the loss of George Lanning. George was a man who never gave up on love. He was a loving husband, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, brother, neighbor, friend, and so many other relationships that George relished in his life. Let this be a time of feelings of gratitude for his life and the acknowledgement of the sacred wheel of life. We especially hold George's family in love today. This is a time for us to acknowledge our feelings of grief together so that we can find the mutual support that we all need. And when we are experiencing grief, we are more open and able to express our true love for one another. And that is a blessing not to be ignored. Today, let us make time to feel our hurt. Let it surface to the sunlight of awareness and melt into tears, that we might become lighter and freer for it. Every one of us here is acquainted with the grief that loss brings, and so we feel compassion for you who feel that loss most keenly today. And finally, let this be a time to reflect upon the deeper meanings and purposes of our own lives. All of the great religious traditions invite us to look beyond the surface and become aware of deeper, constant truths in their ever-flowing stream of life that transcends the seeming finality of death. May we be open to that wisdom today. Yesterday, we buried George's body. We committed his body to the earth next to his beloved Helen at the Odd Fellows Memorial Park. George's spirit has left this world, and he leaves behind many stories and much love. Today, let us be united in the conviction that love within each one of us does not pass away, but grows stronger and stronger from generation to generation if we embody love in our lives.
Thank you.
members of George's family would like to share their remembrances of their father and stepfather. Steve, would you like to come up?
I remember my father as a patient and loving parent. He rarely lectured me or disciplined me, but I always knew when he disapproved. It was his nature to avoid conflict. He would smile and ask questions in an attempt to get me to consider his position. But for me, at least, he rarely continued questioning after it became clear I was not going to get to the same place he was. He might simply state his belief, then we would just move on. Dad was loved by his children, as well as his stepchildren, his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren, his neighbors, and his Unitarian Universalist church community. Dad was born in McCleary, Washington, 1932. Some parts of the family having relocated from Ohio, my grandfather by way of Alberta on his way to Washington, eventually. Grandpa Fred was a photographer, part-time engineer of the Dink, a steam engine for moving timber, a ghost writer for the local paper, and a security guard at the lumber mill. He even made his own enlarger and kept a dark room for developing his photos in the house. My dad also had many poems Grandpa had written for Grandma Ray that we found in Dad's stuff. Grandma Ray also worked at the lumber mill in the business office and preferred to be called Ray. So callers did not know she was a woman, at least on the phone. She also hand-colored the photographs taken by Grandpa Fred for an additional fee to Grandpa's customers. My dad kept a good example of that, of her colorization handiwork, on his bedroom wall, which was a picture of his sister Lita that Grandpa had taken of her. It was clear that Dad and Lita were very close. She managed to visit Dad as recently as last summer. Dad excelled at school and loved music. While in school, he played clarinet, saxophone, and violin. His father was very proud of his academic achievements and gave him gifts each time he was named class valedictorian, which happened twice. When asked what he wanted to be, he would often say, an inventor. Dad went to the University of Washington with a scholarship he received from a lumber business where he'd worked as a summer intern. He was required to take 2 years of ROTC at the University of Washington, and he selected the Navy, in large part because his stepbrother, Ruli, or Raul, was in the Navy, and it turned out that his choice likely kept him from being drafted into the Korean War. He also met my mother, Beverly, at the University of Washington. Like him, she'd been valedictorian of her high school class in Seattle. They married before he was deployed and on active duty in the Navy, and it was on board ship that he came across a book about Unitarian Universalists, which is where his interest in, really started. He learned my mother was pregnant while on board ship on his last deployment. He managed to find civilian work at the Naval Ordnance Laboratory in Norco, California. They first lived in an apartment in Riverside and later bought their first house on Walter Street. He drove a VW Bug with a large spring, and it was connected on the rear fender, bent all the way over the front. His friends made fun of him for having an antenna on wheels. So, probably could have mentioned that he's a ham radio enthusiast. Karen, Chris, and Susan were also born in Riverside. After Susan was born, we moved to Piper Place. I remember being taken to the Riverside Unitarian Church, where later Karen was married. I remember a trip to Mexico to buy guitars, which my parents started playing as part of the Folk Song Society in Riverside. Later, Dad also took up the five-string banjo. My mother and father divorced, and we kids continued to live at Piper Place with Mom. Dad married Roberta and lived in Corona, which was clearly a relatively easy commute, because that's what he'd been doing. But I remember thinking how long that car ride was when he came and picked us up almost every weekend. While in junior high school, Dad was restationed into San Diego, and he bought a house on Point Loma. His office was right at the end, overlooked the Pacific Ocean, beautiful spot. Visits became less frequent, but he was always ready and willing to drive up and take us to and from San Diego. Along the way, he was awarded two patents that was never clear what they were for, some top secret stuff. He worked in San Diego at NOSC, the Naval Ordnance, Naval Ocean System Center, until he retired at the age of 57. He and Roberta divorced, and he met Helen in a bowling league. I remember meeting Helen when he picked me up at San Diego Airport when I was coming home after my first year of graduate school. I didn't know she was going to be there. I'd brought a ton of luggage, not wanting to store things back at school. But there wasn't really enough room, so we piled all the stuff into the back seat, and I drove, and Helen sat in Dad's lap. It was clear they were in love. Dad and Helen bought a small house in San Diego, and my brother went and lived with them on occasion. I sort of knew what was happening then, but I was head down in Evanston working on my graduate school, and Chris was the best man at their wedding. After retiring, Dad and Helen moved to Olympia, which for him was really going home. He was never a fan of Southern California heat and bright sun. He bought land on Lake Cushman and bought a fishing boat with an outboard motor. And in support of that, I'd bought him a trolling motor for his new boat. He and his father used to go fishing frequently, sometimes getting up as early as 3 a.m. because Grandpa thought the fish were a bit better at dawn. There are pictures of Helen fishing with Dad. I never really thought of Helen as being much of a fishing person, but she was definitely into him, so I think that is why she went fishing with him. Dad became very active in the Unitarian Church, and based on his phone conversations, I understood he was in charge of building a new church. Turns out that soon after his arrival, he was elected to the board of the church and almost at once became board president, which lasted for 3 years. During the time, the church changed from a fellowship to Unitarian Universalist congregation, moved old building in Tumwater to this site here in West Olympia. When I first attended the church, on my visits, he sat in the closet and ran the sound system. It was a running joke that he came out of the closet to let somebody else run the sound system. Dad kept a lot of many pictures of his the many visits from his children and grandchildren, and they filled many photo albums and boxes. I have pictures of my girls visiting Olympia somehow after moving from New Jersey to Colorado, which is closer to Washington. We actually visited less. I regret that. But we did. He did get lots of visits from Helen's daughter, Judy, and her husband, Ken, before and after Helen passed away. Helen suffered from Alzheimer's, and Dad did everything in his power to continue caring for her as long as he could. It broke his heart to put her into a care facility. He researched it carefully. The first place he took her, they called like after one night and said she was far too advanced to remain. Just a sign of just how hard he was working to care for her. He took her to a different place. It was much farther away, but he still visited her regularly. She was truly the love of his life. Those who have been in Olympia Unitarian Church will know that she sang in the choir and always had a smile on her face. I like to think he helped her be so happy. After Alan passed, he and Glennis both had eye surgeries, and they holed up at his house to put eye drops in each other's eyes. It sounded to me like the blind leading the blind. But I guess it worked. Dad made a trip to visit me in Colorado for my birthday, but it became clear he was there for more than that when he asked me to be the best man for his wedding to Glennis. The wedding was here in this church. Dad loved cribbage. He learned the game from his father, and after Grandpa Fred had cataract surgery and was coming out of sedation, he was heard counting a cribbage hand. When Dad was lying in the Panorama C&R, Chris and I heard him doing the same thing while half asleep. Dad and Helen played for quarters, and she got good enough at the game that he eventually did not have to give her too many quarters. Sorry. Dad also played cribbage at championships in Reno for many years. When visiting Dad, there were almost always many games of cribbage to go with conversation. While living in Colorado, it was many games of cribbage online. Dad died peacefully with Chris and me at his side Saturday, April 9th, just a week shy of his 90th birthday. He'd been living with pancreatic cancer for several months, but the diagnosis was new, so his death felt very sudden. Now I just want to be as good a listener and as good a friend as my dad as I grow older, and I can only hope to have as many friends as he did. My sister, Karen, is unable to be here today, but she wrote something and asked me to read it. So I'm going to do hers as well. It's in her voice, not mine. My father had many talents and gifts. He enjoyed people and loved each and every person. I know that he was a person who would listen and give advice when needed. I never felt judged, and it was done in a loving way. Being his daughter, we did have disagreements. Of course, most of our disagreements were in my teens. I feel that he was a good father. I will miss him. Everyone will miss him. I hope everyone will miss him in their own special way. Take good care, Daddy. I love you.
Do you plan to read Chris's, or is he going to do that online?
Well, let's invite him to do it, and if he can't, then I'll read it. Okay.
George's son Chris is online, and so can we bring Chris up to for his sharing?
In addition to being accomplished both academically and professionally, Dad was a very caring and compassionate person. He had a lifelong love of music, and he loved a good joke, although a lot of them I wouldn't repeat in a church setting. Dad liked to be on the leading edge of new technologies, which was a natural outflow from his background in maths and engineering. He was an avid ham radio enthusiast, and he liked to build his own equipment. I recall one time Dad was building a new antenna to improve reception for his ham radio, and I went with him to the hardware store. He only needed one nut and bolt for his purposes, and I'm sure he knew exactly what he needed. We nonetheless spent a good 30 or 40 minutes selecting the correct nut and bolt. I didn't find that particular collection of nuts and bolts nearly as fascinating as he did. But that was Dad, meticulous, precise, and deliberate. Earlier, Dad had introduced me to the Lord of the Rings trilogy, which we both enjoyed. One of Dad's favorite characters from the books was Treebeard the Ent, because Ents did not believe in making hasty decisions, and neither did he. So Dad was deliberate, but he was also very patient and kind. I don't doubt that I was the beneficiary of some of that patience. There have been times in my life when I really needed someone, and Dad was always there for me. It made a huge difference. And I know he was there for many others as well. His noteworthy service in the Unitarian Church was entirely consistent with his character. I'm grateful to have had him as my dad. And so I thank you all for being here today to honor his memory and to celebrate a life well lived.
Thank you, Chris. And our last remembrance is offered by Judy Cohen, Helen Lanning's daughter, on behalf of her family. Judy writes, George became part of our family over 40 years ago when he married our mother, Helen. My brothers, Bill and Danny, and I were grown with kids of our own. As one might expect, we eyed the merger with some apprehension. No need, though. There is a greeting card sentiment that states you can't pick your relatives, but you can have favorites. And George was more than a favorite. He became a treasured member of our family, a true grandpa to my kids, Scott and Jennifer, and to Bill and Pat's kids, Michelle and Christine. Bill and his wife, Pat, Danny and Ken, my husband, all agree that we hit the jackpot of stepdads when Mom found George. Eternal thanks to you, Mom. George treated our family as his own. He welcomed us into his life. He taught us cribbage, of course. Showed us the beauty of Washington State through nature walks and beach trips, shared his love of music, and cracked us up with his humor that was funny and witty, but never mean or profane. We shared a love of kitty cats. He showed us that a Tesla Model 3 can go from 0 to 60 miles per hour in 5 seconds. Backing out of his driveway. And even faster on the straightaway, I mean the entrance ramp to the Interstate 5. George was devoted to our mom and cared about her with all the love and respect one hopes for in a marriage. She loved him back with all her heart. In her declining years throughout her battle with Alzheimer's, he was a constant, loving, caring presence, even as he grew weary with exhaustion from caretaking. Eternal thanks to you, George. There are so many memories, but so little time to share. Our family will relive our moments through the many photographs of George playing musical instruments, playing cribbage, sitting at many kitchen tables, telling stories over coffee, and laughing for hours, sharing views on life, agreeing, disagreeing, but always with George's spirit of tolerance and patience for opposing views. Judy says, my son Scott asked to share this tribute. George had an impact on him at a turning point in his life. I think this is a testament to George's patient and giving nature. Scott says, I am grateful for Grandpa George's generosity, patience, and willingness to teach and answer questions about science and other topics. He was a gifted teacher and always took time with his answers because he was as interested in teaching something as I was in learning it. His time with me on his computer was definitely a motivation for my interest in computers and technology. The lessons on the ham radio were awesome. The introduction to computers set me on my path for a career in IT. The time spent wasn't as much as I would have liked, but it was always quality time. And of course, cribbage is always a great way to spend an afternoon. Judy continues, in the last couple football seasons, George began texting me the Seahawks game plays and scores in real time. We would share hoorays and boos, nail-biter endings, and boring blowouts. It was a natural way for us to spend time together without being together. It was a nice routine, and I will miss it come opening kickoff in September. Ken expressed a sentiment to George on his birthday in 2019 on Facebook, and I think it sums up our feelings rather well. Ken wrote, "Happy birthday to a wonderful man, a kind soul, a man to look up to. May your day be blessed as you have blessed others. We love you, George." Judy finishes, "We do love you, George. You are missed, but remembered well. Blessings to you from all of us. Bill, Pat, Christine, Michelle, Danny, Scott, Jennifer, Ken, and Judy." George put together photos from his life. He had many photos. And with thanks to Tim Ransom for putting together these photos of George's life, we'll share them now.
Thank you.
are many stories and memories of George in this space today. We'll make time to hear some of them now. For those online, I invite you to share a quality or brief memory of George that you hold in your heart. You can write it in the chat, and we'll post it on the OUUC website for everyone to see. For those here in the sanctuary, if you have a story that you would like to share, I invite you to come forward. And we'll begin with any members of George's family who might want to speak. I'm seeing a you go, no you go over there. And so there will be time after to share more stories. For any other members of the community who might want to share a story about George, I invite you to come forward now.
There are very few things in my life that have been a constant from childhood on to growing up through my time here. And one of those things has been a Sunday morning in this space, a message, and then a hug from George. I had a really hard time when I found out that there would be no more physical hugs, but I know in this space that his spirit and his presence is still strong with all of us, and that the memory of the hug from George is something that many of us will cherish every time we need it, and especially when we come into this space where he has had so much impact and shared so much love. Thank you.
For those of you who don't already know me by infamy, my name is Bernie Brady. Joan and I knew George from the day we walked in the door about over 30 years ago. And but I didn't know him particularly at all until several years in. We'd already built the building, and we used to do something that was called This I Believe, where a congregational member would get up and talk about what their spiritual background had been and how they had come to be part of this church and what they believed while they were here. George got up here and told his. As far as I'm concerned, he set the standard for the This I Believe event. It was hilarious. He had the best sense of humor of anybody I could think of who could stand up here and do that. I don't know exactly what he said, but I do remember laughing my head off. And every Sunday when we would come in, and I would see George out here in the sanctuary after service, I can honestly say that just seeing him there, and I let him know this, it was a spike in my emotional mood just to see him here and greet him. I'm gonna miss that old dude, as are so many of the people here. He's a treasure.
Well, like Bernie, I've known George for over 30 years. When I first came here, we sang in the choir together, and then somewhere along the line, he peeled off and went into the audio booth, ran the show for a number of years. I think he's the one that put together most of that system. Over time, I sort of took on some of that stuff. But George always impressed me. He was always here. He was always a great guy to see in the morning, just like Bernie said. You knew things were working well because George was there. I remember going to his house one time and being really impressed that he had, as I remember it, a two-manual Hammond organ in his living room. And I thought that was probably one of the coolest things I knew. And some years later, at one of our church weekend retreats up north, George showed up and he was ready to entertain kids or whoever with a plastic toy saxophone, which I thought was pretty cool. The keys worked, but it sounded like a harmonica. George was a great guy. I learned a lot from him. I was a little intimidated by his being a ham radio operator. It was above my pay scale. But he was a good guy. I'm really happy to have known him. And it's made my life better.
Good morning, my name is Jeff Goltz, and I wanted to pick up from something that Bernie said. Mary and I were two in the audience, or in the congregation, when he gave the This I Believe statement. And it was the gold standard, and I remember it pretty distinctly, or part of it. And actually it was that kind of made it clear to Mary and me that we ought to become members of this congregation. He interviewed himself, as I recall, and he got up and he said he was go from side to side. He said, good morning. Good morning. Thank you for participating in this I Believe. It's my pleasure. And the thing I remember the most was he got into the very details of his beliefs. It was something like, do you believe in life after death? No. Could you elaborate? And then he went on to elaborate. But it was that, leading the congregation in stitches and appreciation and actually in awe that this person, 30 years ago, whenever it was, had developed such deep and firm beliefs that he was willing to share so effectively with the rest of us.
morning. I'm Joe Shoren, and my wife Bonnie and I were active members of this congregation for many years and became very friendly with George. And at some point, we started coming less frequently. But I still maintain contact with George. And for many years, we always had an active game of Words with Friends, sort of an online Scrabble type thing going. And we were doing this while I was still working. And there were times where, you know, it'd take me a few days to get back to him. And, you know, he'd fire up three or four more games as a sign of his displeasure with how long it took me to get back. But we always had fun playing and always had at least one game going, often more than one, and he always spanked me. I think he beat me 3 or 4 to 1, but it was just one of those ways that we maintain connection, and it's just nice to know the sort of tentacles that people's lived lives have with others, even when they're, you know, in different places, and they still remember. So thank you.
I'm Sharon Love, and I share everyone's experience of just always finding George here with a smile and a hug and everything, being a big part of my church experience. We joined the church the same year, and I also got trounced regularly in Words with Friends with multiple games, so I don't know how many of us he was playing, but boy, was he good. And I want to go way back when he was president of the board and this building was constructed. It was a testament to his patience because they had to do a patch in the parking lot and it filled with water and the building was here and ready and we could not use it. And it rained and it rained and it rained, and every single Sunday George had to stand before us and we would say, when can we get in the building? And he would say, after 3 days of sunshine. And they just didn't come for months and months, and he just calmly stood before us every single week, and then he would come out here and siphon the water out of the holes in the parking lot every single day to try to hasten that process. And, you know, he just served this congregation in all the ways that have been described, just with that same sort of steadfast, you know, devotion, and I will miss him so much.
Thank you for your remembrances, those that have been shared, those that will be shared, and those that we hold gently in our hearts. Would you please join me in a time of reflection and prayer? These words are from the Reverend Joel Miller. Spirit of life and love, under the vast spiral of time and space, surrounded by the simple blessings of a community of care and love, we carry these memories of George with us back to the community and life he loved. We pray, grant us strength, wisdom, and thanksgiving. Give us strength to speak of our lives so that each day yet to come we find more compassion, more understanding, more of the loving kindness that fills our world with laughter and joy. Give us courage to cherish one another so that we use our lives to heal instead of forget, and lead ourselves to the possibility of forgiveness instead of defiance. And we give thanks for George. His memory lives on in the great spirit of life that surrounds us, and his memory, cherished by us, dwells deeply throughout us by the person George was and still is in our hearts. We have celebrated the cycles of life in which we find ourselves, celebrating life at its beginning and its end, both always present among us. Spirit of love and life, remind us to love as fully as we are able. remind us to treasure our family and friends as they as George treasured his family and friends. And even though we must bid George farewell, the gift of his life is a treasure that cannot be ungiven. We celebrate that George lived among us, and we miss him so very much. Amen, and blessed be. George's death leaves a wide crack in our hearts. May we let the light of his life and love shine in us and through us. George's spirit lives on in us. At such a moment as this, may we remember that we do not begin when we are born. George knew this. He knew his family history, and he shared those stories. George knew that our origin goes back far beyond this to the beginning of all things. Our biography is the story of the sun and the earth, of our parents, our grandparents, and beyond our family to all life. George also knew that we do not end when we come to die. George shared with me that he believes our spirits live on in the love we leave behind. We are a part of all that will ever be. Something eternal is revealed in everything, and our individual lives are pieces of the mosaic of life. For the gift of George's life, and for the great gift of life and of being, of birth and of death, of joy and of love, we are deeply grateful. Let us extinguish our chalices together with these words from the Reverend Greg Ward. Let us acknowledge that we will not, that we cannot extinguish the love that George showed us, or the memory of him, or the love we carry forward. This congregation and many lives have absorbed so much light from George. We will continue to reflect that light. This congregation will reflect that light into the lives of the people who enter our doors, even those who come years from now. May we always be able to see that light as it is reflected in all we do, and remember and smile, knowing George's light is shining from us too. If you are online, please stay online if you'd like to join a small group to share your memories of George. You'll see an invitation pop up that will invite you to join a breakout room where you can share your memories and thank you for your presence today. For those in the sanctuary, you are invited into the commons to share stories and fellowship. Thank you all for your presence. May we go in peace.